Across the world, the entire human population is growing by only 1.1% per year. But it's not evenly distributed in every country of the world. Some countries are showing much more rapid population growth than others. If you live in Russia, that seems like a pretty miserable place to be, and people are not having babies. But in Africa, in parts of West Asia and Arab countries, population growth is huge, over 2% per year, and also certain parts of Central America. These are some of the poorest countries in the world, and they have the fastest population growth. This is where the global population is increasing. Now, if we look at what may happen in the future, based on certain attributes that determine how many children people have, we can break it into several components. If we had some way to control unwanted fertility, that is, if everybody had access to contraception, we might be able to make a difference in population growth by the end of the century by several billion people. Another billion could be reduced if people didn't want to have such large families. But there's also a certain amount of growth that's inevitable because of what's called population momentum. And I'll go through these three topics in turn, beginning with population momentum. Let's look at the age structure of human populations in a number of different countries. In the first, let's look at Nigeria. This is a country with rapid population growth. It's a poor country in Africa. And if we were to line up all the really old people in Nigeria and put them at one end of our distribution and also separate the men from the women, we'd have very few old men, very few old women. And as we come down into younger and younger ages, we'd see more and more younger people because the population is growing. And the most abundant age class in Nigeria are babies, okay? Baby girls and baby boys. This is a rapidly growing population, and we have a clear pyramid in our age structure. If we look at India, we have a similar pyramid, but it's not quite the same as Nigeria because in the last few years, population growth has slowed down. And so it's more like a pyramid on top of a square, okay? Now, in the United States, we had this ridiculous fertile population of people back in the 1950s who at the end of World War II decided to have big families, and that gave rise to the baby boomers, and that's these people here. And then after that, fertility in the US was never as high as it was in those baby boom years. And we don't have that many babies being born per person in our population as, say, in Nigeria, for sure. So what we have here is more like a pyramid on top of a square, okay? Now in Russia, that seems to be a pretty miserable place, and people have pretty much stopped having babies. And so there are very few babies in the population there. Also, life seems to be pretty miserable for the men. There's a lot of alcoholism. There's also a lot of men that were killed in World War II, so we don't have a lot of old men, okay? So that explains this structure. Okay, now I talked about population momentum. Now if you look at India back in the year 2000, that was a clear pyramid. The population was still growing, more babies in this year than there had been a few years before, so that's the most abundant age class. But if we go forward, given the recent slowdown in population growth in India, what we expect to see is that this population will be fairly steady in the number of babies being born each year. And so we have this sort of triangle on top of now a square. It's more like the shape of a pencil, okay? But because we had these very large number of children born in the year 2000, 50 years from now, they're gonna be up here. And so instead of this being a pyramid that narrows down, we have this pencil shape. So the total area under this curve, even though the number of babies is not continued at a high rate, the whole population is much higher than it was before. So people in India have started having smaller families, but the population will continue to grow as these large cohorts in the younger generations reach reproductive age. Next, let's look at unwanted fertility. there are real differences across different parts of the world in access to contraception. These data are rather old now, they're from 1990, but they really emphasize the different aspects of population growth. In the 1990s, the number of children per woman had declined from 6 to about 4 in South Asia, from 6 to 3.5 in Latin America, and from about 6 to only about 2 in East Asia. In Africa, the decline was much smaller, only from about 7 to about 6. And this clearly can be attributed to much extent to the fact that contraception was much more available by the 1990s in Asia and Latin America. It had been missing in the 1960s, was quite common in the 1990s, whereas it was still missing in Africa by 1990. So without access to contraception, women have a harder time controlling their family size. But there's one more factor that's probably the most important of all, and that's how many children people really want to have. And what we've seen in the last 30 years or so is that the desired family size, if you ask women in Senegal, in Jordan, in Peru, how many children they wanted to have back in 1980, the answer was typically between 3 and 8. Now, since then, these numbers have fallen all over the world, but they're still pretty high in Africa. So in Senegal, people still want to have 5 kids. Okay? And we see that quite common in Africa. What is it that encourages some people to want to have much larger families than others? Why is it that some countries still prefer large families, whereas others do not? One of the most important variables in populations of humans is called the demographic transition. And this clearly results from improved economic development. If we look at infant survival, that's a good indicator of how healthy a population is. As infant survival goes up, the number of children that people have declines. If we look at data from Brazil from 1960 to the year 2000, and Sweden from the 1850s to the 1930s, all of these countries had very high typical family sizes, between 4 and 6 children per family. But as infant survival improved, as hygiene improved, medical care improved, economic development increased so that people were better off and their children were almost guaranteed to survive, then people decided they didn't need to have so many children. People said, let's just get by with 1 or 2 kids, and population increments went down quite dramatically. And this is an important factor across the world today. If we compare all the different countries on Earth between their infant survival and the fertility rate in the family, we see the same pattern across countries as we saw within Sweden and Brazil in previous decades. So here we have countries with very high infant survival. Almost every infant that's born is going to survive, whereas over here, maybe 20% are going to die. And with high infant mortality, people want to have more children. It's like an insurance that they will have some surviving offspring. But as they become comfortable with the idea that the child that we have will actually grow up, they prefer to have only about 2 children. Demographers, environmentalists, and development agencies all agree that the best hope for bringing the world population under control is through poverty alleviation. This ultimately would provide the best solution to population growth because people themselves everywhere on Earth will no longer want to have large families. We can see this very clearly in this graph that shows the relationship between economic development within a country and that country's population growth rate. Richer countries that have higher GNP have much lower population growth. Poor countries still have that high growth rate, typical of sub-Saharan Africa and Central America. And economic development is essential for controlling this population growth for various reasons beyond just the demographic transition, beyond realizing that if your child is going to be born, it's going to survive. If you have economic development, you also inevitably have much greater educational opportunities for women. Women have a much more important say in household decisions. If we look at women's education in different countries in the world, we see the same thing, that better educated women have smaller families. So here are a number of these high population growth countries, some from Africa like Niger, Kenya, some from Central America like Guatemala, and where women do not have education, where they don't even have a primary school education, they typically have 7 children. But helping them to complete primary school reduces the number of children they have down to about 5. And if they finish secondary school, then their family size is reduced all the way down to just 2.5. So universal high-quality primary and secondary education has been stated by the United Nations and many other developing agencies as a very realistic goal that could be achieved within the next 25 years. And these differences in population that result from just one fewer child are truly staggering. If around the world the number of children per woman could be reduced by 1, then the expected number of people on this planet in the year 2100 would be reduced by a total of 9 billion people. So what would almost certainly be a St. Paul reindeer crash or an Easter Island collapse of 16 billion people could be avoided through universal education. So here's our island. This is our planet. We have nowhere else to go. We have to solve our problems here, and we have to solve them at a global scale. A Malthusian future, as outlined by Paul Ehrlich and some of the early alarmists, is really terrifying. But rather than trying to scare people, the best solution for trying to deal with a population problem is to stabilize population growth by trying to reduce poverty and educating every man and woman on the planet.